microfabricated as surface thermal sensors. This is the outline of my talk. First, I will give the introduction. As we all know, there are so many applications of terahertz spectroscopy. For example, the applications in physics, especially for the metal and the chemistry, especially for the molecular vibration, vibrational and rotational fingerprints, and the materials, especially for the properties characterization, and the terahertz optics, especially for the functional devices design. Also, it has so many applications in the biological research, for example, the cells, DNAs, proteins, or even water. Based on the biological research, we can do so many works on the medical sciences. Our main job is focused on the biological research. We know the commonly used method for the biological research are usually based on the fluorescence labeled antibody. This method is destructive and time consuming because we should wait for the fluorescence to get the results. So the desired detection approach should be label free and real time and non-destructive and also sensitive and low cost. So this is a perfect detection. From the first three factors, we choose the terahertz speed because it's a real time and non-destructive measure. But when we do the research, we found there are so many difficulties for terahertz biological detection. If we use the direct detection using the terahertz spectroscopy, we can see the time domain we form is like this, and the spectrum are usually like this. So it's very difficult to find the absorption peaks, especially for the liquid samples. It's hard to find the differences for small changes. So it's urgent to find a good terahertz biosensor because the sensitivity is a very big problem for a direct detection. So we should use the metamaterial to realize the terahertz biosensor because metamaterial has played a very great, very significant role in the terahertz functional devices. One of the advantages of the metamaterial-based terahertz biosensor is the sensitivity. It's due to the strong confinement of the EM fields to detect small changes. The other advantage is the low cost because the fabrication conducted by the standard lithography is easy and cheap. This is the commonly used terahertz biosensor structure. Metamaterial, there are so many work about the metamaterial. In the beginning, the metamaterial is three-dimensional. In the past years, we used the two-dimensional metamaterial. It's called the metasurface. There are three advantages of two-dimensional metasurface compared with the three-dimensional metamaterial. It's easier to fabricate and easier to integrate. and easier to test. Based on the metal surface, there are so many applications in the functional devices in the terahertz band. For example, the absorbers, the modulators, the filters, and the sensors. The terahertz sensors based on metal surface can be used in the transmission mode or the reflection mode. If we use the transmission mode, the incident terahertz wave is on one side of the sensor, and then the samples, then the metal structures of the metal surface, and then the substrate, and then we measure the transmitted terahertz waves. So it's the structure is simple. The most commonly used structure is also the SRR structure, and also the newly developed high Q final structure use the asymmetric structures. The biosensors can also be used in the reflection mode. When we use the reflection mode, we measure the reflected terahertz wave on one side of the biosensor because we put the metal plate here, so it can reflect the terahertz wave to the top. However, there are so many difficulties in the ultra-sensitive terahertz biosensor. One problem is the high sensitivity. Another one is the high Q factor. These two factors are very, very important. To achieve a good biosensor, we should have the terahertz biosensor should be very sensitive to the dielectric environment of the samples. The second problem is we should get a very sharp curve for probe, very sharp curve for probe. It means that this biosensor should have very high Q factor. Also, we should have low transmittance or low reflectance at the hot spots. So the transmittance or reflectance, the lower, the better. Also, we should have low loss from the dielectric substrate. So the substrate should be nearly transparent to the terahertz waves. So we designed a L-shaped metal surface bell sensor. Before introducing my work, first I'll introduce the typical zeroness modes in the metal surfaces. The first commonly used one is the LC zeroness, below your alpha minimum resistance. But for the LC zeroness, the Q factor is not so high. We have done so many simulation work. So we can't get a very sharp curve for the probe. So for bell sensor, we do not use this one. The second one is the dipole oscillation. Also, the Q factor is very low. So it means that the curve is very broadband. So it's not good for the bell sensor. The third one is the newly developed fellow awareness with the asymmetric structures. We can't get a very high Q factor with the sharp curve for a probe. But it's not the main oscillation because there are other oscillations there. So we should design another structures for the well-sensing array. We have done some simulation work first. The simulation model is including these parts. First is the incident turn sweep and then the substrate for the metal surface here. And this is the metal surface structure. And this is the channel for the liquid sample. And then the PE window. And then the transmitted turn sweep. Because we can put some liquid samples here and then cover the metal surface on the top, it's convenient for the measurement, so we use this structure. In the beginning, our purpose is to design a polarization independent bell sensor. So the first design is like this. This purpose is for the polarization independent. But we found that the Q factor is low and the oscillation is not so strong. So we try to rotate the four parts of the units with the rotation angle. So the second step is like this. And then we do some optimization for this structure, and then finally we get this structure. After the first design, we do some optimization. The first optimization is for the rotation angle. In the beginning, the rotation angle is zero. It's the typical dipole oscillation we find with this curve. This curve, although its transmittance is low, but the Q factor is also very low. So we get a very broadband curve. It's not good for the bell sense. So we increase the angle to simulate. We get another curve. We find that it's better for the 70 degree or 65 degree. In the beginning, we thought if the angle is 45, which we also can get a polarization independent bell sensor. But when we do the simulation, we found that it's not good for the transmittance. So after optimization, we choose the angle 65 degree. In this case, is that the dipole oscillation, we also get the oscillation with high Q because due to the rotation, we can get some cavities here. So the cavity oscillation should provide some Q factor influence. The second optimization is doing the change the distance between the top and bottom parts. When these two parts are closed, we can get different oscillations. So after the optimization, we choose the 22 micrometers. We get this. This is the best one. After that, we do some simulation work for the performance analysis. We change the reflective index of the liquid samples and simulate the transmittance curves like this. We found we change the reflect index from 1 to 1.8, and then we get the frequency shift. After that, we will calculate the frequency shift rate with the reflective index. And then we get the sensitivity. It's about 26% for reflective index unit. So it's it can be used for the Bell sense with the different reflective index. After that, we also do some simulation work with different channel gaps, because the if we put some liquid samples in the channel, we should know how speed is better. First, we choose a very thin channel. We found that the sensitivity is low. It's not good. And then we increase the height of the channel. We found that the sensitivity has the limitation. Not the thicker the better. It has the limitation. So the limitation is about 25 micrometers. So with the liquid samples, if the thickness of the samples is above 25 micrometers, the sensitivity is almost the same. So this is an efficient. And after that, we also have done some simulation work with different substrates. We found that with the PE substrate, it's better, because PE is transparent in the transparent. Also, we have done some work with other substrates. We think the PE is a much better one. Also, this Bell sensor array can work in the reflection mode. Yeah. In the reflection mode, also the incident turn sweep and the reflective turn sweep here. Also the substrate for the metal surface, structure here, and the channel for the liquid sample here. And the difference is that we put a reflection plate here with a metal plate. We also have done simulation works for optimization and get the sensitivity. The sensitivity is higher than the transmission mode. And the Q factor is higher. So this is the work about the L-shaped mesh surface Bell sensors. Another work is the polarization independent metal surface Bell sensor. It's the first purpose of our work. The design process is like this. Here we use the circle structure with gaps here. In the design, we move the gap. There is a shift from the gap line to the circle center. The purpose is to make the fellow readiness because of the asymmetric structure. And then we rotate the structures like this with the angle of 45. So this structure is polarization independent. This is the optimized structure and parameters. From the simulation work in the transmission mode, we can get the sensitivity of 27.6% for the reflective index unit. And the Q factor is also high. Also, this structure can be used in the reflection mode, like this. We get a high reflective index unit, a high sensitivity here. So then we have done the fabrication work for this structure. For all these structures, here I only give the L-shape fabrication and the test. The fabrication process is based on the traditional UV lithography process. First is the substrate, and then we apply the photoresist here. And then we use the UV light to do the photo etching, and then develop to get the patterns here. After that, we have done the metal film coating on the substrate and also on the photoresist. And finally, we have done the metal film stripping. So these structures are stripped only. The metal surface structure remains here. So after that, we get the bio system every year. It's transparent in the visible neck band and the terrace band. This is the structures. After that, we test this spell sensor by using the terahertz time domain spectroscopy. Our device is the TerView TPS 3000. Use this device, we use the gantry system with the fiber laser outside the main body of the device. So here is the terahertz emitter on the top. And then we put a liquid sample holder here. And then the terahertz receiver is on the bottom. In the sample holder, the bottom is the PE window here to hold the liquid sample. And then the sensor will appear. And then we put a cover on the top. This is the measured results without sample, just the empty chamber. We find the result is as good as the simulation results. So we can see why during the design work, we should get a very high Q factor and a very sharp shape of the curve. It's a purpose to get a sharp Meyer curve, because in the liquid environment, the band can be broad. So after this work, we have done some work for the measurements of some corner samples. So this curve is the air. This curve is for the sesame oil. And this curve is for the crystal. And this curve is for the chloroform solution. These are all the common samples, not the biological samples in our lab. After that, we have done some simulation work with the cells in the solution. with different concentration. These samples are from the Huaxi Hospital in Chengdu. They give us three kinds of the concentration. They use the cell counters to count the cells in the liquid solution. So also this curve is the empty chamber, and this curve is for the lower concentration, and this blue one is for the higher concentration. We can see some small change for the transmission and a small frequency shift. Without the biosensor, we can't find the difference. But with the biosensor, we can see some small differences. And with the higher concentration, we find the curve is broke back. We don't know the reason. We will think it is the cell concentration has some influence on the transmission and maybe some interaction with the metal surface. So these are all our work. So in conclusion, we have done some work on the terahertz sensor, including the design, simulation, optimization, fabrication, and test. There are so many jobs in the future. In the future development, we need to improve the sensitivity and improve the quality factor. Also, the system resolution is another problem. For the terahertz TGS system, if the frequency resolution is not enough to detect the change of the frequency shift, so we can't do the good job using the terahertz bell sensor. So thank you very much.
Questions and comments on this talk?
Yeah, thank you a lot for the very nice talk. I have one question regarding so asymmetric splitting resonator. You have mentioned the structure to create general resonance, and we could see the quantum resonance in the high frequency range. So yeah, what is it? In the higher frequency range, you can see the federal resonance. And it's a very, very narrow. That means it has very good figure bandwidth or refractive in the sensing. So I'm wondering why you don't use that federal resonance for sensing. You mainly focus on the fundamental resonance.
So you mean the final resonance?
Yes.
It's a good resonance with a very sharp curve.
Yes.
Here. Yes. The Q factor is very good, but it's not the main oscillation curve. Because there is another one. During the measurement, we found the problem is that we can't detect this oscillation in the experiment because it's too narrow with the device solution.
Yeah, it looks very easy. Yeah, not very easy to detect because it's very narrow. Thank you very much.
Where you test the cell motions.
The last page.
Yeah. from the 74, the 714, even though there's a very, very small shift, I'm still interested how much is the shift?
How much?
In gigahertz.
Gigahertz. About 10.
10 gigahertz. Okay. And I have another question. Now, would you go to the picture where you test the device?
Yeah.
It seems to me the sensor is put upside down, is it? The sensor array is on top of the PU window. So the channel is between the PU window and the sensor array.
Yes.
So the substrate is here. The substrate, the sensor. And then you have your PU window.
Yes.
And then that will go in.
Yeah. Yes.
By controlling the PU window, you can adjust the channel depth.
In the simulation work, I said there is a limitation.
Oh, so you fixed the channel depth?
Not fixed. Just I put some liquid samples on the PE window, and then I just cover the metal surface structure.